Okay, so the system has problems? What's your solution, though, bro? Communism? I'll have you know that Josef Castro Hitler Zedong built an infinity gauntlet and Thanos snapped half the human population out of existence, okay?
Bro, my dad's from Cuba. He had to flee the country when Castro took his private gold mine and 400-acre slave plantation at gunpoint. Not to mention Stalin and Mao killed 500 million people.
Well, you see, it sounds good on paper, but in practice it turns into the world's largest human factory farm and grinds millions of people into meat every single day.
Horseshoe theory is right. Commies always
on paper it sounds good,
not
but
my
in practice
not
it turns into the
world's
largest human factory farm and grinds millions of people into meat every single day.
Horseshoe theory is right.
Commies always
right.
You hear this talking point repeated ad nauseum, more specifically that communism killed 100 million people. But what do people mean by that? How did they come to this figure of 100 million? And what are the implications of making this talking point? Well, let's talk about that today. First, let's talk about where this statistic comes from. The 100 million dead by communism finds its origins in the propaganda piece titled The Black Book of Communism. The Black Book of Communism was written by a dozen or so reactionary French historians counting everything and anything as a death by communism, from famines, deportations to Siberia, to Nazis killed by communists in World War II, oddly enough. And even then, even after there was a deliberate and clear agenda by the book's lead author, Stephanie Courtois, to extrapolate the death tolls as close to 100 million as possible, he found himself just 6 million short of that figure, with a total count of 94 million. So he decided to round up so he could get his 100 million figure. Gotta take the small victories where you can, huh? So first off, when there is a clear bias and agenda by the authors, whom cherry-pick whatever data and historical events support their conclusions while conveniently ignoring the parts of history that don't, at the same time comparing communism to Nazism, trying to paint the Reds in a worse light than the Browns, it's clear that they have an agenda. And the reason why I know this is because two of the book's leading authors, Nicolas Wirth and Jean-Louis Margolin, have alienated themselves from the work as well as Courtois' political statements. The two have come out and said that they felt Courtois was obsessed with arriving at a total of 100 million killed.
In addition to two of the book's own authors coming out and disavowing it and distancing themselves from Courtois, you also have many other historians such as J. Arch Getty and Stephen Wheatcroft, whom are critical of the Black Book's death toll estimates themselves, and according to their own research, find calculations much lower than the estimates from the Black Book, such as the Soviet famine of 1932. While the Black Book estimates as many as 8 million people starved to death, modern estimates, which are supported by data collected from the Soviet archives, reveal much more modest mortality rates of around 2 to 3 million. That is, if you factor out the increased infant mortality during the famine out of this statistic. And then there's the Great Leap Forward, where Courtois tries to claim that 60 million people starved to death, surpassing even the highest mortality ratings from most mainstream historians. The Chinese government puts the number of dead from the Great Chinese Famine at around 15 million. Most estimates go as high as 30 million, while others fall as low as 200,000. There's no way to know for certain how many people died during the famine, but considering the massive spike in life expectancy at birth under Mao's regime, it would be dubious at best to claim that it was as high as 60 million. Hell, there are even anti-communist historians who know that figure is bullshit, such as Stephen Kotkin.
So you got 65 million globally from communists. People say 100 million because they want a bigger number, as if 100 million is worse than 65 million in terms of evil. Once you get to 65 million, you're evil. You don't need any more from that. Why not stick with the evidence, right?
So in summary, this book and its figures are not really to be taken seriously. Once again, it's more of a propaganda piece than it is an actual historical text. The point still stands that whether it's 65 million or 100 million people, a lot of people died due to the blunders, excesses, and shortcomings of communist regimes. And with all of the unnecessary death, surely capitalism is a preferable system, correct? After all, the argument being made subconsciously whenever somebody brings this up is that more people suffered and died under communism, therefore capitalism is the preferable system. Let's change direction here for a moment. Let me pose an argument to you, viewer. Let us subject capitalism, the global system as we know it today, to the same standards that communism has been subjected to with respect to calculating excess deaths, and see which system is more preferable according to this argument. Starting off, let's talk about war. Capitalism as a system has a propensity towards periodic war and imperialism due to the limits of growth and capital accumulation. Put shortly, World War I and World War II didn't happen by accidents. They were inter-imperialist wars against competing inter-imperialist powers, and these two wars combined killed roughly 100 million people. When you include the Holocaust in that figure, it adds up to about 110 million people. Oof, so right off the bat, we're already at a higher figure than 65 million. But I'm not finished. I have some more examples for you guys. The United States, since World War II, is a war economy and has become an empire of its own. And so it logically follows that the excess deaths that occur due to the non-stop US military adventurism follow as deaths by capitalism, since it is literally the job of the military-industrial complex to bomb countries for profit. Taking into account the Korean War, the Vietnam War, Iraq War, and Afghanistan wars alone that took place since World War II, we already have another 5.5 million skulls to throw in the pile. And how about settler colonialism in North and South America? After all, resource and land theft is very much a profit-driven venture.
The arrival of the European settlers in North, Central, and South America was preceded by the mass dying off of an estimated 56 million indigenous people over the course of a 100-year period, according to a very well-documented research study from the University College of London. The native populaces were agrarian societies, whom had cultivated vast fields of farmland where they would grow their crops. However, with the arrival of the European settlers in the late 1400s to the early 1500s, be it through slavery, genocide, or the introduction of foreign pathogens into the populations of the natives, there was so much rapid dying off of indigenous people that it left large swaths of once cultivated farmland left over to be reclaimed by the forests. In fact, so much reforestation occurred during this period that it actually caused a miniature ice age during the early 1600s, over 100 years later. By studying archaeological and historical data, as well as examining carbon levels left over in Antarctic ice, they were able to deduct that only such massive die-offs of the natives, as well as the subsequent reforestation of their land, leading to mass pulling of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, is what led to the global cooling event in 1610.
And then there's the case of structural violence. We produce enough food to feed 10 billion people globally, and yet roughly a billion people on planet Earth are chronically malnourished. Most estimates place the number of people who die of starvation annually of around 8 million people, with the number of people dying of preventable illnesses typically floating around 3 million people per year, and roughly 8 million die from lack of access to clean drinking water every year. Which means that this system, due to its failure to properly allocate resources where they need to go, leads to an excess of 20 million unnecessary deaths every single year. Extrapolating this data back for the last two decades, that's another 400 million unnecessary deaths due to capitalism. So right now, we're at 570 million people, and I'm nowhere near done counting skulls. I have examples out the wazoo as to how capitalism kills and immiserates billions of people. After all, 70% of the planet's population lives in abject poverty, and it's really only the first world, which profits off of the maldevelopment of the third world, that enjoys the high standard living conditions that it does. So I ask you, reactionaries, do you really want to go down this path of argument? Do you really want to die on this hill? You'll note, though, that whenever this point is brought up to the reactionary, suddenly the conversation becomes so much more nuanced. Suddenly, we have to sit down and have a complicated discussion about the historical context of the situation or what happened and whatnot. When all those people die due to direct or indirect consequences of living in a for-profit world that perpetuates class society, suddenly, that's not capitalism's fault. Capitalism doesn't kill millions of people. But the capitalist system is afforded all the nuance and apologetics in the world for its blunders, repressions, and excesses. But anyone and everyone that died under communist regimes did so simply because communism bad. I hope you guys see the double standard here. And the reason why the double standard exists is because liberalism is the culturally hegemonic ideology. It exists to perpetuate the status quo and keep people trapped in a prison of their own mind. When the truth is that communism is the logical conclusion of all of humanity's struggles for freedom, equality, democracy, and social justice. One way or another, we are going to end up in a stateless, classless, moneyless society where the economy is democratically controlled by the people. And the people who stand to lose out in such a society, well, they're the ones telling you that communism killed 100 million people.